commenting on your solutions to a couple of the problems, the first two problems in the problem set you submitted today. Number one, and I assume you have a copy of the problems, so I'm not going to quote the problems, but we have the time intervals, and the time intervals cluster around 0.162 and 0.168, or numbers kind of close to those. If they cluster around 0.162 and 0.168, and you notice that there are no 0.165s or maybe 164s, 166s, there are a couple of numbers missing in between these, and that's on a fair number of sample points. There seems to be some systematic reason that those sample points, those numbers are not, those numbers in between 162 and 168 are not occurring. And that tells us that the timer is incapable of distinguishing anything much closer than a 0.162 or a 0.168. So our resolution's got to be greater than 0.06. Now, these are in seconds, so we can't be timing any more accurately than to within plus or minus maybe 0.03 seconds or plus or minus 0.06 seconds. And you want to think about that. You want to be very much aware of the fact that our instrument is obviously not perfect. Otherwise, we would expect to see a pretty random distribution of numbers between 0.162 and 168. The distribution is not random, as we would expect from the phenomenon that we're observing. So you want to think about that. It's important for the idea of how you calibrate your instruments. If your instruments are completely missing certain things, then it means the instrument is not accurate to within some resolution. Okay? Now, number two, you have this symbolic situation. You have a ball rolling up a ramp and then down, and the acceleration is either delta A greater than the acceleration you would expect if there was no friction, or less than the acceleration you expect if there's no friction. Again, you have the copy of the problem. You can see how this relates to the problem. Okay, so what we know is delta X equals L, the distance the ball travels up or down the incline. The acceleration is negative of either of A naught plus or minus delta A, and negative because if delta X is L, it's positive, and the acceleration is going to be in the direction down the incline, so it's got to be negative, and VF equals zero. Now, if you get all that together, it's really easy to go to the fourth equation of motion here and conclude that V naught is equal to this expression. I'm not going to do that. You just plug in zero for VF, and A naught plus or minus delta A, negative A naught plus or minus delta A for the acceleration, and L for delta X, and this pops right out. And I guess I should say that V naught should be plus or minus this, but we know that V naught is going to be positive. Now, if we know that V naught is equal to this, and I'll circle the positive to indicate that the negative makes no sense in the context of this problem, then we can go to more equations, and we can get really involved in a lot of terminology or a lot of algebra and a lot of symbols. But at this point, it's advantageous for us to just go to just a direct reasoning in front in terms of the definitions. We couldn't do that here. This is the case that can't be solved just using direct reasoning from the definitions. But now that we know V naught, we can say that V bar is just one half V naught because we know that VF is zero. And then that's going to equal, well, one half of this. If we divide this by two, and this isn't even correct. I'm going to pause here for a second to make sure I didn't do something really dumb. The following, the implications of the whole analysis do hold water, but let's make sure I didn't do something really, really stupid here. Okay, just wanted to make sure. If we divide by 2, then it'll be equivalent to dividing by 4 under the square root. 2 over 4 is 1 half, thus we're going to get the two here. It just didn't look right to me. It looked like I was dividing by two and getting a two here, which I knew wasn't going to be right. So I had to stop and think about that. Okay, so that's true. It's a good thing it is, because our conclusion wouldn't be right if it wasn't. Okay, from this, that implies that delta t, which is the length divided by the average velocity, is going to equal this. Now, you can fill in the details of that. You can divide L by this and see that you get this. Alternatively, of course, you could just divide L by double the expression for V naught, and you would get the same thing, and you wouldn't even have to find this V bar. Okay? Now, going on, turns out then that going up the incline, we're going to get the shorter time because the acceleration is working with the gravitational component, and our delta t is going to be equal to the choice here with the greater denominator. Now, you could work through the details of each model, but this kind of reasoning does kind of shortcut the process and save you a little bit of time. And going down the incline, you're going to get the longer delta t, which is going to correspond to the lesser denominator here. So you're going to get these two delta t's for up and down, so that the difference is going to equal this. Now, in finding the difference, I subtracted the shorter from the longer. I subtracted the shorter from the longer. They both have a square root of 2L, so I factored out that square root of 2L, and I was just left with 1 over this minus 1 over this. Again, think that through. Write it down, work it out, convince yourself. Okay, so the difference comes out to this. Now, I'm going to use a couple of common approximations that are used very often in physical reasoning. And these are things that I would hope you saw in your calculus, first year calculus course, but you're not going to see that in every first year calculus course. First year calculus course aimed at engineers should, or physicists, should definitely include this, but a general first year calculus course might not. So that's, again, an instructor choice. But very simply, the square root of 1 plus or minus a small number epsilon is going to be approximately equal to 1 plus or minus epsilon over 2. Now, you can evaluate that. Let epsilon be 0.01 and evaluate the square root of 1 plus or minus 0.01. Square root of 1.01 is going to be 1.005, which is going to match 1 plus epsilon over 2. Now, that's not going to be exact. It's going to be 1.00 something very close to 5. And similarly with the minus, you're going to have something very close to 0.995. 1 minus 0.01 is 0.99. The square root of 0.99 is 0.995. Very close. The square root of a number close to 1 is basically twice as close to 1. The further you get from 1, the less true that is. And you can analyze that with differentials. You can analyze that in any number of ways. And also, the square root of 1 over 1 plus or minus epsilon is 1 minus or plus epsilon. For example, 1 over 0.99, which would be correspond to epsilon, equals 0.1 minus 0.1, subtracting a 0.01 from 1. That's going to give you about 1.01. 1 over 0.99 is close to 1.01. Check it out for yourself. Convince yourself. Use your tools of calculus to convince yourself that this is true. Okay? Now, using these approximations, the approximation that the square root of a number close to 1 is twice as close to 1 on the same side of 1. So if your number is bigger than 1, the square root will be a little bigger than 1. Or 1 over a number close to 0.1 is about that close to 1, but on the other side, so that 1 over 1.01 will be 0.99 on the other side of 1. 1 over 0.9 will be 1.01, which is, again, on the other side of 1 from the 0.99. Using those approximations, first thing I do is I factor out the a naught from the denominator, that leaving me 1 minus square root of 1 minus delta a over a naught, and 1 plus delta A over A naught. Now, you need to do that algebra. But if you take these expressions and factor out an A naught from both of them, do your algebra. And this is algebra that you do need to be able to do. So if you don't understand how to do that, get me some questions, look it up, work on it, beat your head against it a little while. You need that much algebra to be an engineer, okay? If you do that, you get this expression, and you get the square root of a naught here, and it leaves you with these things. Delta a over a naught is a small number, so we use the approximation that the square root will be twice as close to 1. Gives us this, just using one of these expressions, and this expression will give us this. And then we do just a little more algebra, and you should be able to do this. You put this over a common denominator, you're going to get this in the numerator here, you're going to get this in the numerator over here, and you're going to get 1 minus 1 half delta A over A naught quantity squared in your denominator. Well, delta A over A naught is small, 1 half of that is even smaller, and when you square something that's pretty small, you get something that's really small, so that the denominator is essentially going to be 1, and you get this approximation, and then you find that the difference comes down to delta T naught, and delta T naught is the time you would get just using acceleration A naught. So make a little note, delta T naught is the time if acceleration equals A naught. It's that midway time between what you get, the longer time you get due to acceleration going up and the shorter time you get due to acceleration coming back down. So we write the square root of 2L over A naught, and we call that delta T naught. And you can work out the fact that that is the time it would take on a length L with this acceleration. And I guess we should say acceleration negative A naught. Okay. And then that's times delta A over A naught. Half of that difference will be half of this, which is delta T naught times 1 half delta A over A naught, meaning the percent uncertainty in your time, which is what this would be. You can again think of the details, is half the uncertainty in your acceleration, because the uncertainty in your percent uncertainty, now let's say half of the percent uncertainty in A would be like delta A over A naught. This is 1 half delta A over A naught. So again, you want to think about that, and you want to think in terms of being able to deal with expressions like this. That's an ongoing process. You're not going to get it immediately, but we're going to keep coming back to it. So you should do your best to understand this solution.